Good morning and welcome. He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. In that, let us worship God. Let us come before God in common confession. Let us pray. Merciful God,
thank you.
Friends, the God who claims us at these waters, who nourishes us at this table, this Lord is merciful and gracious and abounding in steadfast love. This God does not deal with us according to our sins, nor reward us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heaven is above the earth, so great is God's mercy towards those who fear and turn towards God. And as far as the east is from the west, so far has God removed our transgressions from us. For in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen.
Please be seated. Good morning and welcome to Westminster. Whether you are worshiping with us online or in the pews, we are so glad that you are here. To help us stay connected, please sign in using the instructions provided on the card in your pew, in your bulletin, or on the church website. We especially want to connect if you are visiting with us today. These links will also help you find our digital bulletin, make an online donation, or share a prayer request. Today's flowers have been given by Deborah Wells in loving memory of her mother, Beverly Owen, and by the Woodrow family in celebration of mother, grandmother, and great-grandmother, Faye Woodrow, on her 92nd birthday. As the summer comes to a close, next Sunday the 12th marks the beginning of a new year at Westminster. We will return to two services with the 8:30 a.m. service in the chapel and the 11 a.m. service in both the sanctuary and online. At the 11 o'clock service, the Westminster Choir and Old Town Brass Ensemble will join us with special music, which includes The Road Home by Stephen Paulus, Light of a Clear Blue Morning by Dolly Parton, and Beethoven's Hallelujah from Christ on the Mount of Olives. Between services, we will kick off Adult Formation Hour with a discussion of our theme for this year, which is rekindling. This theme was inspired by Paul's words from 2 Timothy, "I remind you to rekindle the gift of God," written during a period of isolation and uncertainty. Join us in the Westminster Room or online at 9:45 a.m. And please note that as we head into the fall, masking will continue to be required for worship and other indoor events. We will also have outdoor fellowship in the courtyard after the 8:30 service and lemonade on the lawn following the 11 o'clock. There is still time to sign up for two upcoming formation opportunities. During the school year, Pastor Larry leads two in-depth, year-long courses focused on reading the Bible. Beginning this week, Old Testament classes will begin on Wednesday mornings and New Testament classes on Sunday afternoons. Both will be taught in a hybrid in-person and online format. And then join your fellow saints of Westminster as we gather to experience the Amen Corner at the Shakespeare Theater in DC on Sunday, September 26th at 2 p.m. Written by world-renowned author James Baldwin, the Amen Corner tackles the role of the church in the Black community. You can sign up for both of these events by this Tuesday, September 7th, and you can find the signups and all of our announcements on the church website by clicking on the Worship tab and then the Announcements section.
Olivia will be at the 8:30 service if you can find the chapel. You've probably never been in there yet, right? So, but it'll be great to return to that that facility, which we have had probably no event in since March of last year. So I'd now like to invite the Vecchies up Jonathan and Rosalie and their son, Jonathan Michael Jr. And Kristen Bishop will be our elder. This is a special baptism for me. I did their wedding about how many years ago?
Almost
4 years ago. They kind of wandered into Westminster looking for churches and took all of the Bible classes and, had their wedding here. And now Jonathan Michael, who is in the 90th percentile of height, is from that. So I expect great things from him throughout his life. They have since moved to that faraway state called Maryland. So we don't see you all that much anymore, but it's great to have you back for this. So hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always to the close of the age. Obeying the word of our Lord Jesus and sure of his presence with us, we baptize those whom he has called to be his own. In Jesus Christ, God has promised to forgive our sins, and he's joined us together in the family of faith, which is the church. God has delivered us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, Jesus Christ. In Christ, God has promised to be our parent and to welcome us as his brothers and sisters. Know that the promises of God are for us all. By baptism, God puts a sign on us to show that we belong to God, and he gives us the Holy Spirit as a guarantee that sharing in Christ's reconciling work, we will also share in his victory. That dying with Christ to sin, we will be raised with Christ to newness of life. Jonathan and Rosalie, in presenting your child for baptism, you announce your own faith in Jesus Christ, and you show that you want your child to study him, know him, love him, and serve him as his chosen disciple. Will you show your purpose by answering these questions? Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Do you intend your child to be his disciple, to obey his word, and to show his love?
We do. Okay.
Our Lord Jesus Christ instructed us to teach those who are baptized. Do you, the people of the church, promise to tell this child the good news of the gospel, to help this child know all that Christ commands, and by your fellowship, strengthen the ties this child has with the household of God?
Let us pray. We give you thanks, O holy and gracious God, for in the beginning your word moved over the waters unseen. By the gift of water, you sustain all of life. We thank you for this gift of baptism, for in this water we are buried with Christ in his death. And from this water we are raised to share in his resurrection. As we baptize with water, baptize us with the Holy Spirit, so that what we say may be your word and what we do may be your work. By your power may we be made one with Christ our Lord in common faith and purpose. Amen. Now with the whole church, let us stand and say what we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed, which grew out of an original early practice of baptism in the church. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. What is the full name of your child?
Jonathan Michael Vecchi Jr.
Okay. Jonathan Michael Vecchi Jr., I baptize thee in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And may the blessing of God, the Father, Son, and Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord God, we praise you for calling us to be a servant people and for gathering us into the body of Christ. We thank you for choosing to add to our number brothers and sisters in faith. Together, may we live in your spirit and so love one another that we may have the mind of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom we give honor and glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Let us stand and sing our baptismal hymn together.
The offering is a time when we acknowledge all that God has given to us from the very beginning until the very end. Today, we want to take this time to share the sad news that two beloved members passed away this week. Sarah Schramm died on Tuesday, and Nancy McKeever passed away last night. Both services are in the process of scheduling and will be announced in Thursday's EGRAM. An offering, we also practice giving as a reflection of our trust in God. So we invite you, like these saints, to give your time to serve others, to give financially or at the doors, online or at the doors, or to share your talents with this community of faith. And in gratitude for all that God has given us, let us pray. God of provision, we thank you for the lives of these two saints. Ask that you would give comfort to their families and draw them close during this time of grief and remembering. Just as they spent their lives loving others, we thank you for all the opportunities that we have to participate in your work in the world. We offer you our prayers, our presence and gatherings like this one, our financial resources, and our service to others. Please bless these efforts and multiply them so that all our neighbors would know the depths of your love for them. Amen.
Please be seated. As we receive hard but an unexpected news, as we live a life full of ups and downs and everything in between, we have the Word of God to nourish our way, to be a lamp unto our feet, a light to our path. And to that Word we attend for comfort and for direction today with the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Listen now to God's word to us through selected passages from the book of Proverbs. A good name is to be chosen rather than great riches, and favor is better than silver or gold. The rich and the poor have this in common. The Lord is the maker of them all. Whoever sows injustice will reap calamity, and the rod of anger will fall. Those who are generous and blessed, for they share their bread with the poor. Do not rob the poor because they are poor, or crush the afflicted at the gate, for the Lord pleads their cause and despoils of life those who despoil them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
About 7 years ago, I went on a mission trip to Philadelphia, where we were serving with Broad Street Ministry, which is actually a ministry that Westminster Youth have gone to serve with as well. And we learned a lot, but I'm going to share with the kids today and with all of you two of the lessons that we learned. The first was about the importance of choosing your words carefully. You have probably encountered people who might have less than you. Maybe you have encountered them at school or out in the community. Well, in Philly, they taught us that having less money, less food, or not having a home right now is a difficult time that some people go through. And it is not a way that we should describe someone. So a lot of times you might hear someone say that someone is a homeless person or a poor person, just like we might say they are a tall person. But at least for grown-ups like me, height doesn't really change. And our living situation and our resources sometimes do change, and we hope that they would change a little bit more. So this description is also usually one-sided. You would probably not describe me as a housed person or a full person. So why is it that we only describe people as homeless or hungry? So instead, they taught us to say a person experiencing homelessness or a person experiencing hunger. This way, we talk about the person first, and we are clear that this is a temporary situation, even if sometimes it lasts for too long. And we do not always need to describe people this way. Sometimes on our trip, we would just say, my friend Mary, or a man I met today. But sometimes, if it feels like this detail matters to our story, we should make sure to use people-first language. The second lesson that we learned was a little bit more personal. We met up with a group of people experiencing homelessness to sell newspapers that they wrote and published themselves, and they did this most every week. It was a newspaper that was full of good news, and it also raised money and awareness about homelessness. The newspapers were only a dollar, and they sold them outside a busy area with lots of restaurants for 3 hours at lunchtime on a workday. So how many newspapers do you think they sold? They sold 2 newspapers in 3 hours. We talked about this later with all of the youth, and some of them shared the different strategies that they used to try to sell more newspapers. One youth shared that they tried to be louder so that people could hear them. They would say, the good news daily, or weekly, only a dollar. But people still didn't really stop to get a newspaper. Another youth shared that they were surprised that they didn't sell more newspapers because our group was there. They thought that their age, or perhaps their brand name clothing, would get people's attention in a way different than someone who is older or maybe didn't have nice clothes. So our youth were trying to use their privilege, the extra gifts that they have, to help people experiencing homelessness, but everyone still walked by. So we all learned something that we were not expecting to. We did not learn how to use our privilege that day or how to stop homelessness. We learned how it feels to be ignored. We learned that when you stand beside a person experiencing homelessness, most people turn their eyes and walk on past. So our new friends shared that they sometimes feel lonely and sad after selling newspapers And it was not because people didn't give money. It was because most people are not comfortable to offer a smile or say good morning. And none of us have ever forgotten that feeling. So to this day, when we see someone who is experiencing poverty or homelessness, we all make sure to meet their eyes and offer them a smile or say good morning. Sometimes that means giving up some of our time if they want to have a conversation. Sometimes that means we might give them some of our resources to help them. But oftentimes, it is just a quick and easy way to treat another person with kindness. That is my story for today. Let us pray. God, thank you for stories like this, for people who teach us how to be more like you. We love you, and we are thankful for you. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, today we hear or we see your word made visible in the sacrament of baptism, and we see your word made visible in the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. And as we now prepare to hear your word proclaimed through the sermon, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight and give you glory. O you who are our rock and redeemer, in the name of Christ, amen. So as we end summer, return to school a little earlier than people in this area are normally used to returning, hoping in person that the nature of the in-person return lasts. And then as we buckle up for what may prove to be a longer road trip through the Delta than we had anticipated making this fall, akin to returning home from vacation and now having to go on an obligatory trip. With all this going on, it's worth taking stock of where we are and looking forward. Our Old Testament lectionary passage for today is one of the rare selections that we have from the book of Proverbs within the three-year cycle of readings that constitutes the lectionary. Proverbs is the book in the Bible that contains almost exclusively wisdom literature. The literature that the late scholar R.B.Y. Scott defined as arising out of the moral experience and trained intelligence of genuinely religious people. Moral experience, trained intelligence, genuine religious faith. Proverbs begins with nine chapters of a father in a relatively affluent urban household seeking to train his son in the humility and respect for God that the son will need in the adult world. Then as chapter 10 opens, it is as if the son has graduated from high school, left the safety of the home, and is now out in the world on his own. One of his tasks is to sort out from all of these proverbs and saying that he's inherited at home, to sort out which applies to this situation and which applies to that situation. By the time we arrive at chapter 22, which is where our passage is from, the subject turns to how one is to live as a person of privilege with appropriate and faithful responsibility for the world, specifically for the many people whose privilege is much less apparent or real than the young man has inherited at birth. Chapter 22 addresses privilege and responsibility. And on that basis, it speaks to us. I need not remind you of the privilege that nearly all of us in our congregation enjoy in our personal and professional lives. When I moved here in 2004, I learned that the congressional district in which we live and worship is typically ranked in the top 4 or 5 nationwide in both level of education and level of income. That has not changed in the years since I've been here. It was true before Amazon, and it will be true after Amazon. Many of us and our children or grandchildren who live in this area have access to some of the best schools in the country. And because of our financial resources, we can afford to make choices about schooling that fits their needs. While we are not living in New York or Paris, the arts we enjoy in our city offer us beauty and rest and intellectual stimulation and moral challenge. They can lead us to laugh with comic relief and to cry with personal introspection. We are a people of privilege. Very few of us have to be nervous about, fearful of, or even careful around police, whether we're stopped for a traffic ticket violation or for no particular reason, if in fact we are ever stopped. If we face trouble personally or professionally, we generally know who to call, and with some not insignificant juggling of family funds, we can usually manage to pay for the services we need to protect or advance our interests, even when we've made serious mistakes. Our personal safety net, almost always private and familial, often provides us with nearly unlimited second chances. We are a people of privilege. I was recently startled to read that in the Presbyterian Church, only 2.1% of all of our congregations have over 800 members. Now, I have never considered myself a large church pastor, but with 1,000 members and holding, that means we're somewhere in the 1.5%. It gives a whole new meaning to that phrase. And on top of all of this, if we can sort of put COVID aside and just look back to as recently as 2 and 3 years ago, after what seemed like decades of waiting, our city finally saw sports championships come our way with the Nationals and the Capitals and some sport called hockey and the Mystics. We are, in so many ways, people of privilege. But we wouldn't be in this sanctuary, or we wouldn't be watching live stream, if we didn't already know that with privilege comes responsibility. The verses selected by the framers of the lectionary for our reading for today all speak to this responsibility. And several of these verses are really timely. Verse 2 reads, "The rich and the poor have this in common, that the Lord is the maker of them all." Despite the vast differences in economic circumstances, differences which have come to bear the title of income inequality and which have increased during COVID, Wisdom literature reminds us as a simple tenet of our faith, namely, that the Lord, Yahweh, is the creator of us all. It is a theme that Proverbs repeats several times throughout the book, nearly always enjoining the rich to be generous to the poor. One verse even eloquently claims, "The Lord gives light to the eyes of the rich and poor alike." At birth, we all open our eyes to the same light. Last week at the Chautauqua Institute in Western New York, a place of privilege in and of itself, Maggie and I heard Evan Osnos, a journalist with the New Yorker magazine, a magazine of privilege in and of itself. Osnos, who is in his early 40s, shared that he had lived for 13 years covering events as a foreign correspondent in major hotspots around the world, Cairo, Baghdad, Beijing. And in the past 8 years, he's lived back in the D.C. area with his wife and two children. All of those years overseas, he said, he continued to find himself compelled to make a case for the United States. He said, "For all the failings of our country, we stand for some basic moral commitments, some deep moral commitments, including the rule of law, the force of truth, the right to pursue a better life. We believe," he said, "we believe in these big ideas." He then quoted F. Scott Fitzgerald, "France was a land, England was a people, but America was a willingness of the heart." A willingness of the heart. We hold these truths to be self-evident, our founders wrote, that all men are created equal, equal. Unlike land or blood or soil or ethnicity or religion that defines so many other nations, America is founded on an idea that all people are created equal, and we survive only as our hearts continue to give willing assent to that idea. The rich and the poor have this in common. The Lord is the maker of us all. This leads to a second proverb that is before us today, found in verse 9. Those who are generous are blessed, for they share their bread with the poor. In Hebrew, the word generous literally means good of eye. It is not just the writing of a check and the transferring of stock, the opening of the pocketbook, all of which are very good and necessary things. Please keep doing these things. But generosity is also seeing, really seeing someone else's life and experience. Fleming Rutledge, a name you will hear several times this fall, writes, "Trying to understand someone else's predicament lies at the heart of what it means to be a Christian." Goodness of eye is what we develop when we try to understand the condition in which other people live, the experiences they have had or inherited as individuals or as a people, the struggles they know, the beauty they behold, the humanity they share among themselves and with us, their hopes, their dreams, their aspirations. When we become good of eye, we cannot help but share our bread because we have come to know people as created by the same God who created us, as born into the same light of day into which we have been born.
My friends, even though we are a largely white church, there are ways that we can develop more goodness of eye, ways that we can learn what people of different colors and backgrounds experience in our world, so that we might be part of a new day in our church, in our country. We have myriad of opportunities to develop and stretch our goodness of eye. Our adult education programs that start next Sunday, a play we will attend at the end of the month, a civil rights pilgrimage to Alabama this spring, and opportunities to be involved through several, if not many, of our mission programs to work alongside people from all different races and backgrounds locally in Arlington and Alexandria, in Appalachia, on the Spirit Lake Indian Reservation in North Dakota, and at Moyes Bridge in Kenya. And there will certainly be ways emerging in our community and perhaps in our church in which we can help with the welcome and resettlement of thousands of people from Afghanistan in our country. In addition to such programmatic and volunteer response, nearly every day where we work and live, where we teach or write, where we or our children go to school, where we render service to our nation through military or civilian service, or the many other jobs relating to governing our country, we each of us have the opportunity to try to understand someone else's predicament and to respond, the heart of what it means to be a Christian. Those of good eye are blessed, for they share their bread with the poor. And finally, a third proverb in our reading for today, in verses 22 and 23, provides a bit of a word of warning. Do not rob the poor because they are poor, or crush the afflicted at the gate. For the Lord pleads their cause and despoils the life of those who despoil them. In the urban society in which biblical wisdom developed, the gate refers to the public square where all matters of justice were decided, where all matters of civic import were decided. One of the most compelling black writers that I've been reading over the past year is Jesse McCarthy, a junior faculty member at Harvard. In much of his writing, he exudes a realism about how deep and long-standing the problems in our criminal justice system are, and how they've existed and negatively impact people of color in our country. But he is also cautiously optimistic, maybe even more than cautiously, that all that we've seen since Trayvon Martin and Ferguson, Missouri, and George Floyd is leading more and more Americans to see certain things about black history and life in America that can lead us to more goodness of eye and generosity of spirit in working together. Speaking of and to black people in America, but implicitly speaking to us all, McCarthy writes, "As in past struggles, our principled defense of an ethical legal code has attracted others as a moral force. Even many of those who do not agree that the current problems in policing or prisons or courts are the result of actively racist policies and attitudes. Even they no longer deny that our exceptionally poor record cannot plausibly be unrelated to a long history of anti-black violence and antagonism. For this same reason, he continues, like-minded people around the world are hoping for a decisive break with the past, taking to the streets to demand that we can and should work together to design a new social contract that will restore the perceived legitimacy of law enforcement and criminal justice in the eyes of all citizens, not just some. McCarthy concludes, all the uncertainties that govern the question of what can be done, what will be done, and the difference between these two, all of these questions remain in our hands. We are not at an impasse against an implacable enemy. We can lift each other and we can rise together with the spirit of history at our backs. We have done it before, and every time we do it, it's a new day. In his speech, Evan Osnos told a story about John Gunter, who, after serving as a war correspondent in World War II, returned to the United States and traveled all over the country asking people, what do you believe in most? He characterized his most frequent response as being, the people, if you give them an equal break. 70 years later, in local precincts and halls of justice, in school boards and legislatures, local and state, in all arms of the federal government, the Lord still pleads the cause of the poor at the gate. The goodness of eye that God has toward the afflicted can become our own goodness of eye as we truly see the predicament in which people live. We can believe in the people and the break they deserve. For the Lord is the maker of us all. We are born into the same light. Our church, like our country, is a willingness of the heart. We can lift each other and ride together with the spirit of history at our backs and with the spirit of the Lord infusing all that we do. This is goodness of I. And this is where we start. Amen.
Thank you.
Please be seated. So as we prepare ourselves to receive the gifts of this table, we remind everyone that in our tradition, the Presbyterian Church USA, and at this church, we practice what is called open communion, meaning we welcome all baptized Christians to the table, regardless of denominational or church affiliation or membership, including all children in that invitation. And we welcome all who are exploring or seeking faith to also partake of this bread and this cup that are before us. Jesus said to rich, to poor, come. All that you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. I am, Jesus said, the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Blessed are all who hunger and thirst for righteousness. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Let us pray. Eternal God, holy and mighty, it is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, and to worship you in every place where your glory abides. You sent to us your Son, Jesus Christ, who died and rose again to save us. By his death on the cross, you revealed that your love has no limit. By raising him from the grave, you comfort us with the blessed hope of eternal life. And by his victory, you assure us that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, can separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the heavenly choirs and with all of the faithful of every time and place, who forever sing to the glory of your name. Holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. You sent your only begotten, in whom your fullness dwells, to be for us the way, the truth, and the life. Revealing your love, Jesus taught those who would hear him, healed those who believed in him, received all who sought him, and lifted the burden of their sin. We glorify you for your great power and love at work in Christ. And by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made us a new people by water and the Spirit. Remembering all of your mighty and merciful acts, we take this bread and this wine from the gifts that you have given us, and celebrate with joy the redemption won for us in Jesus Christ. Accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, as a living and holy offering of ourselves, that our lives may proclaim the one crucified and risen. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. And by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. And as this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world until the promised day of resurrection, when with the redeemed of all the ages, we will feast with you at your table in glory. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. And he said, This is my body, broken for you. Take and eat and do this in remembrance of me. And then in the same way, he took the cup, and he said, This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink of this cup, do so in remembrance of me. Friends, by the work of the Holy Spirit, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. By the work of the Holy Spirit, that which we drink from these kits is tied and bonded with the bread on this table, which is tied and bonded with the body of blood of Christ in us and in the world. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Sing the Lord a new song, to praise him, to bless the Lord. I will sing his praises while I live all of my days. Blessed is the man who loves the Lord. Blessed is the man who praises him. Louder, 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 and walks in his ways. I will lift up my eyes to the hills from whence comes my help. I will lift up my voice to the Lord, singing Laudati. For the Lord is my shade, is the shade upon my right hand, and the sun shall not smite me by day, nor the moon by night. Blessed is the man who loves the Lord. Louder, and walks in his ways.
Mm-hmm.
laudi, lauda, lauda, di, da, di, dei. All of my days.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we do give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into this world joyful, adoring, and strong in the strength of your Spirit, that we may give ourselves for others in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who is our rock, our Redeemer, who gives us eyes to see. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, instead of the briar the myrtle, and it shall all be for the Lord a memorial, an everlasting sign that will never be cut off. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the face of the Lord shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the countenance of the Lord be lifted upon you and give you peace this day and every day. Please be seated. Thank you.
Please greet one another with the peace of Christ. Peace of Christ.